I'm going to talk about type. I'll actually have two talks. The first talk is entitled, "Do we need what we don't need new fonts?" which was a fairly provocative statement, but it's a positive one. It started as an article which I wrote last year, and I was questioning. I teach at the Royal Academy of Arts in The Hague. I teach type design, and it's fantastic to see how many people come and study type design, and how quickly they learn and acquire skills necessary to produce type. And in this article, I make a question of, you know, it's one thing to learn the skills to produce type, and it's another thing to know how to use the skills. In the same way how learning how to use the language, you know, if I learn a grammar of English or Portuguese, doesn't really make me a writer. You just have the skill set possibly to produce something with it. With type design, it's the same. You need to first acquire the skills to be able to produce something. But after doing it, you need to reflect on how to use these skills, how to contribute to what is there already. But essentially, although the title sounds negative, it was meant to be read like this. No, we don't need new fonts like this. And there was a slide which showed a lot of fonts which are just derivative, things which follow an existing example. And they tried to follow certain models, which you know they were successful, and you know to bridge to make the differences between different typefaces small and smaller. This is a real example from my fonts. If you search for Garamond or Renaissance-inspired fonts, you get this. If you look for Humanist Sans, you know you find many cases where you cannot really recognize what it is. There's so many derivative typefaces. And people don't really reflect on why doing it. So the question was about, well, we need to think how to use our skills. It's important to learn them, but publishing a typeface, it's quite a commitment. So in publishing, you need to really see how you contribute to the larger statement. And I'll be talking about this magazine in a bit, but I'm only showing it to make a parallel between type design and type design publishing and publishing in general. If you publish anything, if you publish a periodical, like what we do with the magazine, the process is not really simple. Even the simplistic model shows there are many phases. So starting with writing, writer delivers a text. The text needs to be edited. And often in a magazine like ours, the magazine goes through 5, 6, 7, 8 rounds of editing before it gets to the form where it seems to be, you know, almost ready to be published. Only at that phase, we start doing the fact checking. Every single fact in it has to be checked to be sure that you deliver correct information. After that, you know, it goes through the proofing period, and we have 4 different levels of proofing to make sure that you don't have spelling mistakes, and to be make sure that things are consistent within the magazine. Then things are being designed and enhanced by infographics and captions. And finally, it gets to the phase of being ready for publishing. So it's not just writing and publishing. There are a lot of in-between steps. Which brings me back to the subject of type design, that you know a lot of people now, technology allowed us the democratization of technology allowed us to produce typefaces directly on a computer. And from the same computer, we can publish them to sites like MyFonts with one click. And it's one single person involved, and they're not merely in between steps. So people get the idea that you know it's really type design, and then there's a production, and then it's publishing. While in reality, type designing and publishing are separate activities. And why they're separate is that the publisher offers the critical look at the work, and when it's single-handed, when it's self-published, you lack in this component of seeing, you know, what again it brings to something. It doesn't really make sense to produce what has been done. You know, obviously, no writer would publish what has been written already. And as a type designer, I think our responsibility is to do the same, to do what hasn't been done. So the role of the publisher, the editor, is really to, you know, to see the wider perspective and see, you know, what this particular work, how it can be possibly improved, edited, and then how to prepare it for publication. So this would be a typical, I run a small type foundry called Typotech, and when we publish designs by other designers or ourselves, you know, it goes through separate stages. So there's a production, and then we reflect of how how we can bring it to the standard that is set by our library. Then we have to see how to present it and possibly publish it. I don't know if you see what is this. This is a poster which I have in my studio on the wall. It's not really a poster, it's a calendar. I'll show you like this. It's a calendar of the 21st century. It starts 1st of January 2000, and it ends in 2100. And every day when I come to studio, I check one day. So, to see really the things in a large perspective. And what this poster allows me to do is really, see that every day is important and to see, where we are at the moment. What is interesting is my other work is really about graphic design. And if I look at my work, this is work from 10 years ago, it's rarely relevant. A lot of the things were ephemeral and they're forgotten and they don't work really. They don't have a story to convey 10 years later. If I look at the typefaces which I designed 10 years ago, or text which I wrote 10 years ago, they have a bit more relevance. And in fact, most of the fonts which are now fairly successful from my collection are fairly old. They are 10, 12, 15 years old. So the typefaces have possibly a lot longer life shelf life. They live longer. They possibly can survive the author, which is incredible. And I think this is important to think about this, that a lot of the typefaces which I use in my work, the authors are not alive anymore. So again, it's crazy to think that whatever I'm doing right now can possibly outlive myself. And although it started, with this almost negative statement, we don't need new fonts, I think we do need ones. There's still room for creating new ones. And if you reflect to the period where we live, you can find many reasons to create new typefaces. And you reflect them by looking at the needs of a typeface. And if you look at the typeface, type design is an interesting discipline because it works at the intersection of three separate disciplines. You work with language and you work with linguistics, obviously, because the language is, typeface materializes, type materializes language. Language is purely abstract and it's very direct. Type is artificial. It's this extra layer put on top, which captures language and makes it, tangible. Linguists don't care about typography. They don't care at all. They work with language purely. Written word is outside of the domain of linguistics. So suddenly, type is really in the limbo. It's not really linguistics, part of linguistics. It's no longer really design. It's somewhere in between. Technology is very important. Technology has always influenced typography. Yesterday, if people saw the Linotype movie, they could see really a relationship between technology and type. And finally, of course, for the lack of word, better word, I call it design, but it could be craft, could be art. It is the place which kept, which influences the aesthetics and it brings the artistic skills of designer. And you need all these three different skills, which are taught normally at three different schools. So if you learn language and linguistics in a different school, then you study technology. And you study design in a different school, again, that you study the other two fields. And to be able to do type, you need to combine all three things, which that's the reason why it's not so complicated, not so simple, because you need to acquire knowledge of separate things. Or you need to work with someone that helps you with other things. Traditionally, you find a publisher that takes care of something else which you don't know. And if it's self-published, you need to know about these things. So it is combined. I'll briefly talk about projects and how to show how technology influences or projects which predominantly use the technology. I mean, the technology comes forward, and historically we can look at, for example, work of John Baskerville, which many people he would be the one that would advance a lot of technology, printing technology of the time, and consequently, his work would benefit from that. It would be a lot sharper and but often criticized by the people that would be so different to your eyes, to the previous examples, because he would improve the paper, he would improve the inks, he would improve all the steps which are necessary to reproduce type. And it shows that, again, it's not only the design of punches, but it's really about the way how they're presented that makes the result complete. We can think about other examples where technology comes to hand. This is obviously a project by Matthew Carter, Bell Centennial, created for the phone directories in the 70s, and where the actual design of shape is very different than what people perceive on paper. And Matthew Carter would introduce these ink traps, and it's a well-known example of, you know, what you see and what is designed is a separate thing, because he would understand the process of getting from, you know, from the design process to the reader. It's a long way of translation. It's a translation that you have to control. In a school where I teach at the Royal Academy of Arts in The Hague, the course Type and Media, which is about learning how to design type, we put a lot of emphasis on understanding tools, understanding, you know, it's technology, understanding the tools which are used to reproduce type. And they go from the most basic ones on from the oldest ones, like stone carving. And we end up with new tools, and new tools, what is it? For example, digital tools. Instead of using ready-made tools, we encourage people to understand how digital tools work. So part of the course is programming. The people script and have to understand, you know, how scripting and programming works, because again, it's really about understanding the tools that are available. It doesn't really produce programmers, that's not really the point, but the way, if you understand how programming works, it affects, you know, your mindset, it affects how you think about type. You start thinking about workflows, and again, it possibly can improve your design work. I'll show you some projects which we did. This is an example of Divani script. Divani script is one of the styles of Arabic which was invented by the Ottoman dynasty, and they held the Arabic script and calligraphic tradition to the highest esteem. Because there wouldn't be any technology to follow, this is purely handwork. There is no such thing as a baseline. It's just flowing in space and time. It's incredibly elaborate and beautiful. The problem was for Arabic is when we introduced technology which can replicate Arabic, it was not really meant to reproduce scripts like this. It was really meant for Latin. If you compare Latin with Arabic, you see obvious differences. The Latin sits on the baseline and it's very static. The Arabic jumps around and, you know, it's very vibrant, it's very lively. I work with Christian Sarkis, a student from Type and Media, and this was his final project in Type and Media, a project called Turaya, which is a Divani-inspired Arabic typeface, where, you know, Christian designed a beautiful shapes, but he had the problem of, you know, conceptually proposing shapes, but then not knowing how to translate them to any existing technology. If you know tools like FontLab, FontLab would not allow you to create digital font, which would allow you to create slanted baseline. It would simply be not possible. So what do you do? Would you compromise and not do it, and, you know, consequently changing your design? Or would you think about changing the tools and fully express your design potential? We decided to go to the more difficult way, and to create the tools that allow you to fully do what design proposes. Again, if you would, most of design software packages are made by programmers. They don't really think about the needs of creative and expressive person. So necessarily they come with a lot of limitations. I think our role is to go beyond these limitations and think in a different way than the programmer who made the tools. And that's why making our own tools become part of our job. These are the tools which we made. I think it's the first Macintosh-based software that produces ready-made Arabic font for publishing, which I was very happy to work with Eric van Blokland, a friend of mine from The Hague, who is a designer slash programmer, understands technology, and would be able to come up with, you know, solutions for these problems. And we would be able to create tools which, again, allow us to use slanted baseline, for example, and consequently, you know, be ready to publish typeface like this. In this project, many things come together. There was artistic skills of the author, so to be able to design something which was essentially very beautiful. There had to be linguistic skills and to be able to know how Arabic works. And finally, you know, the technical component was very important. So three things came together and made it a strong project. If only one thing would be up to the level and the others two not, it becomes a problem. I will speak slower, which will take more time. But we have enough time here. Okay. Very complicated diagram. I like diagrams. This is a sketch which I made 5 years ago when I thought about web fonts and all the components which are necessary to show type on screen in the browsers. It is complicated, and it's so complicated that if you're trying to explain it to someone, they will give up. So you have to, at the end, hide the complexity and present it in a very simple manner and prepare the workflow that, makes it look appear very simple. Again, as running a Type Foundry, my job is to design type, but also publish it and to make it usable for others. And we'd like to see our typefaces used by in all different media in different languages. And that's why it was in our biggest interest to make our typefaces usable on the web. And that's why we would be probably the first Type Foundry which proposed the web font system before companies like Typekit came out. Which hides all this complexity, which I showed before, and it would just reduce it to three, small steps for people to use web fonts, and by choosing which language you want to use, which font you want to use, and it would generate code which you embed in your website, and you could run the font. There would be a lot of technology involved, and again, understanding how artwork is modified, and how to make it usable. So again, there's a lot of things that has to happen, which is beyond just drawing type. This is work by Janon, often presented as Garamond, published by the Imprimerie Nationale, by the National Printing Office in Paris. It's called the Caractère de l'Université from 1530. And what it shows the same design, how it's interpreted in different point sizes. So the top example, it's a 6-point version of Janon's typeface, and the bottom example is 36 points. And you see that although they are similar, they're very different as well. The contrast between thick and thin are very different. You look at the position of the dot on over the eye, like how it changes position, the details, how much they're much more refined in the other example. And the reason is simple. You cannot do the same thing in the very small size because you had to cut it into metal. And then, when you have more size, have a bigger size available, you can really introduce more details. This is called optical sizes, and it temporarily disappeared from digital typography because people would simplify it and would want to have one model of a typeface rather than having different optical sizes. I'm talking to it as an example of, this is an example of hinting. And hinting, you may know, is a very tedious technique to improve rendering of fonts in smaller sizes. On the right side, is the original A of Fedra Sans, how I drew it in my design software. I would spend a lot of time finding the ideal shapes which look optimal to me in print. But this is not how people see it when they use it on computer in small sizes. They see something different. That outline is scaled and modified and basically distorted when it's reduced to the smaller size. And what designer can do is that through process of hinting can control the distortions or the modifications of that outline. So that outline, you see, it's modified in different point sizes, point size by size, how it's being changed by process of hinting, in order to control really the bitmap appearance. In a way, it's a modern version of optical sizes, which we know from metal type. We're just trying to make sure that it is optimally readable, legible in small sizes, and you cannot do the same size in small and large sizes. And that's what makes this typeface, again, the combination of the technical component and design skills, and possibly also the language skills, make it, you know, a unity. I come back to language, which again, that's the primary way how you think about type, that type really is the expression of language. We often see typefaces as being, you know, voices. They're as different, you know, as different voices are recognizable and familiar, different typefaces do the same. They offer familiarity, they often, you know, recognition, and that's why people use them for identity. A voice offers identity and informs person about you. Typeface does the same. The first time I started talking about thinking about language and type was when, you know, I come from a small country, from Slovakia, and I had to design accents and diacritics for Slovak language, so I was forced to create extensions of standard character sets. Later, this extension continued, and from, you know, small limited set, it grew larger and larger. And I was fortunate that I came across this project, which was this is dictionary project for HarperCollins. And I worked along with Mark Thompson, the art director at Collins, to design typefaces or to modify typefaces for these dictionaries. And because dictionaries are obviously bilingual, we had to look really to extend the character sets and to create phonetic versions, create Cyrillic versions. At the end, creating very large sets of glyphs to support as many different languages as possible. Because this dictionary came with supporting over 200 languages. If you look at Latin type, what is standard by now is that a lot of Latin fonts support many different weights, many different widths, and I mean, it is expected that there are the italics available, and you can choose from a range of styles. We don't have the same expectations when we look at non-Latin fonts. If you look at fonts, for example, Greek fonts or Cyrillic fonts, or if you go even further, if you look at Hebrew or Arabic, suddenly, if you look at the Arabic font, it often comes with one weight or two weights. You rarely find anything more than this. I think the largest typeface family with supporting Arabic has four different weights, nothing more. That's the largest package you can find. If you look at the index things, you are lucky if you find one style that supports it. There are completely different standards that comes to Latin and non-Latin. What we did in Typotech is we try to apply the standards, not the way of working, but the standards of working that we know from Latin, that we know that it worked, we apply to non-Latin as well. This would be example of a work in progress, which is basically Greta Sans for Arabic. There's no reason why there should be only condensed typefaces in Latin and not in Arabic. There's equally, you know, they're equally needed in publishing to have space-saving proportions, or wide ones, or to have different weights and widths. And we would do the same. So we would try to articulate or bring, you know, our knowledge from what we use for Latin and apply it for the different writing scripts. And to make sure that it works hand in hand, because a lot of the projects in the Middle East, they are not published in one language, but they're often Arabic and English, or Arabic and French. So we're creating tools which work, you know, across different writing scripts, following the standards, but, you know, the high standards that we used to from Latin type. 4 years ago, or 5 years ago now, I started a company together with my colleague Satya Rajpurohit in India, a company called Indian Type Foundry. It's a type foundry, and although type has been created in India before, but it was mainly made by software companies to support software. And type was not considered to be really important part of it. it was just, you know, treated as afterthought, you know, as an extension of the software. We tried to look at type as an important aspect and create typefaces and started with research to create, you know, to use the possibilities which are available. We would first need to, you know, do a lot of research to understand, you know, what are the character sets and what are the technical requirements. We would collect, you know, a lot of samples to make sure that we don't repeat mistakes of the past, because often technology which was made for Latin was imposed on index scripts, and we would modify, distort, change, you know, the foreign writing scripts. So we would go back to writing to understand, you know, how the different writing scripts work, how many glyphs they need, and how they need to operate. Based on this research, we would create fonts and our own standards, which often are very different than standards used in the past. This would be the first font published, which would be extension of the Latin. But by now, there's about 10, 15 different projects published by Indian Type Foundry. And I'll show you one in detail. This is a writing script and language called Kannada. It's used in the south of India, in Bangalore, the state of Karnataka. Bangalore is a bigger city full of IT, full of technology. But for some reason, if you look at all the newspapers and websites in that region, they would use the same one single font, which would be available for Kannada language and works in text sizes. There would be a few display fonts, but for use in a smaller size for newspapers, you would find one. This was a little analysis of a newspaper called Prajavani, and we were invited to make a proposal for Prajavani newspaper and to see what was wrong with the current sample and possibly to improve it. While the newspaper put so much attention to the level of writing and editing, they would have this one voice which would be identical to all the competition. They would not be able to find the uniqueness in their graphic expression because they wouldn't have the tools which allow them to do so. And again, we know from Latin type how important it is to, you know, choose the right gradation, how to optimize typefaces for small use. So why not to bring this into Indian typography? And we would do so. So we would create a set of tools that allow newspapers to, you know, create their unique product, their unique newspaper, starting with the text typeface and ending with a series of display typefaces. And this is, you know, this was a sketch, a mock-up of see like how it could work like. Again, there's a combination of, you know, the language skills, the technology skills, and design skills to be able to do something like this. And it's not the team of one, not the work of one person, but more people. Although Satya Rajpurwal was instrumental for this project and did extremely a lot. I keep coming back to this diagram, and I'm going to expand it now because, in a way, this is still reduced. You know, like a diagram is always reduced. What this forgets that there's history as well, and each of the subjects have its own history. So technology has its own history, design has its own history, and language has its own history and development and evolution. And we forget that we work with the accumulation of different layers, and we're building our work on century of different inventions and innovations. And what we do now, I mean, in our work, that we're trying to use whatever has been made before, and we're trying to be faithful to the period of now, and use the opportunities that we have now. So, you know, there's this layering which is available. And I'll show you one project which uses history as one of the components in the work. And it's a very expressive project. I mean, most of the students, when they talk about type design, they complain that most of the ideas has been already made and explored and realized. And it's true, you know, currently we have over 100,000 fonts available commercially. So it's a lot of work. It's very hard to find what else can you do. But still there are large areas of unexplored, you know, areas of design, what you can do. And because we live in a very different, complex, layered world, I think this is what we can do to use, again, the knowledge that we have now, not to look necessarily purely in history, but look at, you know, how this time is different from the previous time. I started the project a while ago when I was trying to look at the evolution of Latin capitals, how surprisingly they stayed very similar. You know, if you look at the Trajan column, if you look at lettering, Roman lettering from 2,000 years ago, it looks as beautiful as it did, you know, many centuries ago. I tried to trace all the archetypical changes, what has happened, you know, in 15th, 16th, 17th, 18th century, and see if it was possible to create one typeface which is informed by longer period of history. Traditionally, when you create typeface, you look at one point in history. If you're creating a particular revival, you look at, 17th century, and you study the samples of that time, and you're trying to be coherent and consistent to this period. This project tried to do the opposite, look at all this evolution of Latin typography and bring it all to one type. And the idea is not really mine. I mean, I borrowed it from Czech writer Milan Kundera, living in France. And there was this one particular book that influenced me and which I really like, which is called Immortality. And in Immortality, Kundera proposes that, you know, in a novel, what you can do, you can create polyhistorical story. And what he means by polyhistorical is that you mix different histories in one. He mixes it that way that he could create a dialogue between Goethe, a German poet which was long dead, and combine in dialogue with someone who's alive in 21st century. So you would have a dialogue from, you know, 17th to 21st century. He used it in many other, in following books, that, you know, he would mix different centuries into one book. And this would create uniqueness of his work. This typeface called History does something similar. It starts on a skeleton of a Roman capitals. It looks at how type has changed over time, how different contrasts were introduced, how different series were introduced, different ornaments and fills, and creates a tool set that by producing the different layers, you can replicate what has been made in history. So you can choose, you know, the basic skeleton, apply, you know, the Renaissance contrast and Renaissance serifs, and you get something which looks very similar to Garamond. It mimics what has been done in the past, or mimics what has been, you know, the first line mimics how Didot or Bodoni looked like. And then by replacing the serifs, you get something, you know, which looks like slab serif, or the third line looks like Caslon. This would not be particularly interesting because you recreate what has been done. Funnier things happen when you combine different parts and from different centuries. So you take the contrast from the Baroque time and combine it with the 19th century slab serif serifs, or you take a, you know, a bitmap version of from late 20th century, combine it with the Bodoni serifs, and you get something unexpected. You get a tool which allows you to, you know, explore different centuries and allows you to remix different parts. Of course, this tool allows you to do terrible things as well. You know, like most tools, tool doesn't guarantee any particular results. But you know, you have a possibility to create something new. It was important because the tool itself was fairly complex. We had to create an interface on top of it because it's 21 different layers and different fonts. Combining them in Illustrator is not simple. So there's an interface with this where you just click which layer you want on. You can color them and it generates PDFs. I'll mention briefly one last type project, which is a recent one. It's probably the last typeface which I made. And that project looks, I've been always very hesitant talking about how type can be conceptual. A lot of project students want to create conceptual typefaces where the ideas are stronger than their execution. And I always argued that, you know, you need to be able to execute ideas, and they cannot be, you know, purely abstract ideas. You need to combine the skills of a maker and your ideas. And it's very difficult. When the idea is stronger than its execution, it suffers. And that's why it's not really easy to create conceptual typefaces. I had a lecture about it once, and there I considered you know, possibly what would make a conceptual typeface is when you combine something which, again, didn't really exist in the past. And I was particularly interested to look at, you know, what constitutes beauty in type. And there are some models which are appreciated as and celebrated as particularly beautiful ones. Bodoni is one of them, where he would achieve technically and aesthetically, you know, a certain level which was unprecedented for the period. A few centuries later, this is an example of Italian from 19th century, which was considered by many as the ugliest example of type ever produced. It would be immediately criticized and said that this was such a terrible thing that it should disappear and doesn't have a right to exist. And you can see what people did. You know, what they did is that they're trying to surprise the reader by changing what should be thick and thin. It defeats the expectations. It's completely trying to trick your eye. And it comes from the period when there were so many new typefaces made that you had to create something new which grabs your attention. And this would be, you know, a one particular way to grabbing someone's attention to read something. I was curious to see, like, if I could create a link between, you know, the beautiful typeface and the ugly one and create one coherent typeface out of it. And at the end, it was surprisingly simple, you know, that if you look at them closely, you could put the same structure around them and create, you know, possibly one typeface family. I worked with Peter van Rosmalen, a friend, a Dutch designer, and we would draw, you know, something which we considered to be, you know, Bodoni or Didot inspired high contrast typeface. But drawing it with the idea that it was a little bit of a compromise because it would anticipate another step where we would reverse the contrast mathematically and create basically, you know, an ugly font, deliberately ugly font out of this. So this would be first beautiful one, which I think it's fairly convincing. And by reversing the contrast, we would get this. But it's the same typeface, which would be this monstrous Italian-inspired degenerate font. But if you look at them closely, you know, it's basically the same thing. It's the same skeleton, just completely, you know, mathematically reverse the contrast. So if you would interpolate them, and interpolating is blending these two models, you'd come to something which is very neutral. So you get something like this. And that. It allows you to, you know, a project like this, first, of course, it's fun to create because although the two parts of it existed separately, by connecting them, you create something unique and allows you to create different kind of design, I believe. You know, that you can play with this, that you can have the beautiful and ugly part and you can play along with them. This typeface is called Karloff. And that's the Karloff is the artistic name of this actor, and you know you see him in Civil Life, and you see him in where he was an English gentleman, you know, who would sing children at Christmas time, and then you know the same person would play Frankenstein. I'll show you a small movie that presents typeface.
For millennia, mankind has endeavored to capture the ideals of beauty. We have sought it in divine proportions, symmetry, and harmony. We struggle to define it, yet we know it instantly if we see it.
Ugliness is different. It assaults our expectations, violates all canons, twists conventions. Ugliness repels us, yet also commands our voyeuristic attention.
Karloff is the convergence of beauty and ugliness.
The nexus between the extremes.
The manifestation of their common ground.
Ugliness and beauty intertwined.
This is Karloff.
This animation was created by two French students, Thibaudot de Fournas and Chris Wilson. So I'm thinking this is their work. I just made a script for it. I'm getting to the end of my presentation where I started talking about, you know, we need to reflect why and how making typefaces. And by, you know, going around it to show that there are still plenty of possibilities. There's still plenty of areas which are unexplored. One of them is really looking, you know, at different parts of history and possibly connecting them. The other thing is using a different languages which haven't been really explored. And again, while we have 100,000 fonts available for Latin, for some particular languages, when I worked in India, there were none, or there was one or two. So they're still, you know, looking at language or looking at technology. You know, 99% of fonts which are made today are made for print use. We never really thought about what happens in lower resolution to them. So technology also offers new entrances to design typefaces. So at the end, it is terribly exciting time to draw type because you can reflect on all these possibilities and use it for your own work. Thank you.